man. It's Ebro in the morning. Laura Stiles Rosenberg is on assignment with ESPN. Friend, family friend of the station, the show. Give it up for DJ Clark Kent on the program. Look, you even got a Juanito, the tallest Mexican sighting in here because we're going to have sneaker talk.
Uh-oh.
And you still live that life right now.
Nah, he lives that life.
Yeah.
But so does Laura. Laura's you live the life, too.
I'm not there like I used to be.
I'm not as crazy as I used to be, but I appreciate it.
Nah, it's always clean.
Wait. So you guys agree that Ebro's not in that sneaker life like he used to be? When Ebro came to New York, he was so about it.
Yeah, but he's definitely calmed down. He's a very Vans man. But every now and then he'll come out and try to stunt and try to wear something and act like nothing. But like, what is happening?
No, you see how I said it was Izzy, right? He was like, nah, it's not the check. It's just a choice.
I just, honestly, when we was really chasing sneakers early 2000s.
It was fun.
It was fun because it was really like if you had something, you had something.
100%.
Either you sat on it from the 90s, right? And you brought it in the 2000s, or you really knew someone, or you went and found somebody who was sitting on something that wanted to get rid of it. Like, it was a real...
It was a hunt.
It was a hunt.
Yeah, and going digging, it was the most amazing thing.
Yeah,
especially if you knew somebody at an old store.
I was going so hard that I was the eBay dude. I would find someone on eBay, and then I've tripped and got a bunch of bootlegs before and been like, nah, this is fraudulent. They never did this. This didn't exist.
I never did eBay.
Shit is cheap.
You don't understand. Before, I used to come to the station more frequently. I would come see him. I was working at record companies. And I never came, like, soliciting records to him. It was always like, hey, how you doing? And we would have a half an hour sneaker conversation. And that's it. And I wouldn't be here to solicit a record.
Yeah, but we was on sneakers.
I mean, big time.
And we was talking about, in the early 2000s, Clark and I was already talking about what it was going to be like once the companies found out that we was... Everybody that was somebody wanted expensive, exclusive sneakers.
Yeah.
And soon after that, that started to bubble. Clark was a part of that with Nike early on. The boutique started popping up. The trading started popping up. And now it's the whole thing. You got the, is it still the Ultimate Sneaker Expo?
Absolutely. Ultimate Sneaker Expo happening on September 17th out in Smithtown, New York, deep in Long Island for the kids.
Yeah. Now, and when you say deep in Long Island for the kids, is that like geographically located because there's a lot of people who live in Long Island and in the suburbs that are heavily into the sneaker thing more than in the boroughs?
Actually, because we live in New York, we take for granted that we're the only ones who really get that busy. But if you go to a sneaker show anywhere, it's usually kids from the suburbs that are there spending more money on sneakers. So when you give them their own show, it's almost like a Christmas party for them.
Yeah.
So when you go out there, one, they're having fun because they didn't have to get on a Long Island Railroad and risk their lives to go sell sneakers and come back home with $6,000 to get
all that.
Right. The might get robbed section is crazy. And then the parents are happy because their kids aren't risking their lives doing something that they already think is crazy.
And the sneaker expos are dope. I did the Westchester Sneaker Expo with him.
Yes, she did.
And it's beautiful because you get to see, I love seeing the parents really, like the kids are like super psyched to go buy, sell, and trade. And they're very supportive of them. And just, you know, to me, I love seeing kids excited about something instead of just hanging out and doing nothing. You know?
And so the one that's coming up, what's the date again?
September 17th.
September 17th. And is this like you buy tickets now somewhere?
Yeah, ultimatesneakerexpo.com. You can buy tickets. It's at the Sports Center in Smithtown. And the Sports Center is huge and it's dope place that every weekend they have 1,000 kids in there anyway playing games and ice skating and roller hockey. It's crazy arena area where we're just going to blow it out and put a dope sneaker show.
Is it still, I haven't been to a sneaker expo in a long time, is it still like you have people who set up their tables, like their vendors as
well? There's vendors, right? There's resellers. There's
DJs playing music.
Absolutely.
Performances still.
We don't do performances at our thing because, you know, we're DJs. So we just get the DJ up there and let him have his fun.
But it's cool because everybody gets to talk, meet new people. Like, it's really, really dope. It's a dope social environment. Like,
the one thing I can say, and adding to what she's saying is, what she's talking about, you can't talk about that at another sneaker event.
What do you mean?
About how she's saying that, you know, it's fun.
Ah.
And the DJs make a big difference because they're DJs who are coming and they're actually having fun. They're not these guys who are like, I got a DJ at a sneaker event.
Oh, and they're sneakerheads themselves.
Yeah, that too.
Many of the DJs.
Yes.
So they're excited about the whole thing.
Right. So it's like when they get off, they're walking around. They want to see what they got.
And they treat it like a concert, though. They go in.
Yeah, the DJs go in. Like Fat Fingers loses his mind every time.
Yeah, he's great.
Yeah.
He's great.
So it's dope.
The Sneaker Expo thing, I had never done. I remember they used to do, what was it, Sneaker Pimps?
Yes.
Had a movement for
that
a while.
Was more like a concert.
That was more like a concert. Flex, obviously, with the car show.
Right,
Sneaker bike show, Sneaker Expo, collabo thing.
Right. I used to get down on that.
Yeah, you was on that heavy. And the competition of who had the what, and they would go around to the different booths.
To win
Sneaker
best
cats
vendor.
Would vote for the best vendor. That shit was tight. But the evolution of this, what was the first ones of this? Like, who was really doing this
first?
To
me, the first ones, I would have to say, would be Sneaker Pimps. They were, I would say they were first to take it somewhere else. But the thing is, when you went to it, it wasn't like it was a big...
It wasn't vendored.
It wasn't, like, vendored out. And it wasn't resaled out. It was, come and show off your collection. And we're going to have this guy performing.
Right.
See, this is buy, sell, trade. You come in... You could buy sneakers, you could trade sneakers, you could sell sneakers. It's vendor-driven. It's okay, y'all are going crazy for sneakers. Come here and go crazy for sneakers. Be safe. Be happy. Just have a good time.
The economics of the sneaker thing so has changed dramatically since, you know, I was involved. I remember Nike specifically several years ago saying, listen, the aftermarket is making money without us. We're going to dead that. So they started releasing more, you know, Jordans, more pennies, more whatever classics into the marketplace via their retail outlets so that they could kind of squash the aftermarket.
Impossible.
How has it affected it?
It's only affected pricing. It hasn't affected the actual aftermarket. Here's the deal. If you got 10 shoes and you're going to put out 10 shoes that were out back in the days, pick the right 10 shoes because you could put garbage. And if you put garbage out there, then it's not going to work.
And do you feel like Nike's picked some garbage to re-put out?
Every company's picked some garbage. I wouldn't. It would be wrong to just say it's Nike. Like
everybody.
Yeah, but that's because the people at these companies work at the companies. And they don't go outside, so they don't actually know. And they're not in the sneaker game, so they don't actually know. If you get a kid from the sneaker game and you put them in a company, every retro will be the best shit.
So how do you determine what is the best retro?
You just go back and put them on with a pair of jeans. I know it's
but there's not but it's simple. So it's how it looks. It's not necessarily the year or the,
I mean, people have their favorites also.
Everybody has their favorites, but think about this. If you want to put the best retros out, they have to look right on your feet. So you can delete a bunch of retros. And then you could look at the shoes that just weren't.
But see,
the
now
shit.
You're talking about taste, right? Now you gotta have taste. You gotta have style.
See, and that's the thing. Most of the kids don't actually have that much taste. They just have belief in the hype. So if you're just putting a bunch of stuff out, they just believe, or the story that you tell makes them either believe or not believe.
That's the hype beast.
Right. And think of, and that's the market. The market basically is the hype beast. So if you go back to when Jordan was rolling, 1 through 14 was all money. Then you started to get to 15, 16, 17, and it was a little questionable.
Facts.
You know what I'm saying? So when you put them back out now, like, you think I'm going to be hype off of something that wasn't right from the beginning?
Yeah, don't give me no 17.
Right, it would be whack. So, like, let's say there was an Air Force 12, and you knew it was garbage. Don't put that Air Force 12 back out. Don't put it out. Just because of the nostalgia of an Air Force 12, like, don't do that. You know what's right. Put the ones that are right back out. Right. But if you're in the bubble... You don't know what's right.
And mathematically speaking, you know, it's interesting that you say that, is because oftentimes when these shoes came out, they're more popular now than they were then. So if you're looking at the sales of them, it may not tell the whole story because there's retros.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
That probably didn't sell that much, but meant something culturally.
Right.
Right?
Jordan 1s.
Yeah.
Jordan 1s, Jordan 2s, Jordan 3s.
Yeah.
1,
3s was
three.
The explosion,
nah,
though, wasn't it?
4 was the explosion.
4 was the explosion.
When it was...
I thought it was a dunk contest with the 3s kind of took it.
Nah, that was cool for the guys who really understood.
Got it.
But the game changed when Spike Lee was like, is it the shoes? Money, is it the shoes?
Shoes.
It's if that didn't happen, the shoes wouldn't have never become a character.
That's
the shoes are a character.
Go ahead, Juanito, the tallest Mexican.
So I always thought that Spike Lee helped... like Spanish folks and black folks relate more to Jordan, buy him more, because we saw Spike Lee in the movies and it kind of related to hip hop. I think that would, to me, that's how my brothers got into it. And then they kind of showed me, yo, when we saw Spike, we just jumped on Jordan.
I hear you. I can't say that for hip hop. And the reason why is because before that, Three Times Dope were wearing threes on their cover.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, in the streets, you're in the sneakers. Hopefully. If you want to be fresh, you got to dress from the bottom up. And if you're dressing from the bottom up, your sneakers got to be right. So, you know, the real I Want to Be Fresh guys, they understood Jordan 1s. They understood Jordan 2s and 3s. But the game changed when, yo, money, your sneakers are broke. Like, what do you mean my sneakers are broke? Because he stepped on it. It was a Jordan 4. The Jordan 3s were in She's Gotta Have It. And they were basically a character. But you didn't pay attention to She's Gotta Have It like you did Do the Right Thing.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
So, Do the Right Thing happens. Your shoes are broke. Money isn't the shoes. I'm sorry. If you do a commercial and it's not Mike you're paying attention to, you're paying attention to the shoes, you honestly didn't even care if it was Mike
and Clark,
at that point.
Clark, speak to the seed that had been planted, obviously, in the hood, in America, when black men went to play professional sports, right? And that was our hero.
Right.
Like, you are a hero now.
Exactly.
And so when Clyde or Ralph Sampson or, you know, the Shell Toes or...
What's crazy is...
Or, you know...
The Shell Toes were big because they were the right ones to break dance in.
Right.
Because they looked like they were indestructible. But
well,
the
and
fly
you could
guy,
stand on the toe.
Yeah, but the fly guy wore Abdul-Jabbar's because his face was on it. And then the skyhook was on it. He was aspirational. Right. Nobody was more aspirational than Walt Clyde Frazier. Not in New York.
Right.
I mean, Pumas were before Shell Toes.
That's right.
Like, people wanted Pumas because we saw Clyde.
Puma and with the fat lady.
Dude's name was Clyde.
What? Yeah.
Like, it was even cooler. And then it was written in gold on the side of the sneaker. Ooh. Like, that's Jesus Christ right there. And then if you...
But the reason I'm taking it to a cultural aspect is because when you was trying to be fresh...
Yeah, your
and
heroes.
And you wanted to be luxury. The basketball player was luxury to us.
But
that was the life that we...
But it's Clyde.
They was making the money.
But Clyde's the reason.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Because any picture you saw of Clyde, he was wearing a fur coat. He was super duper fresh. And he drove a Rolls Royce. And when he jumped out of that Rolls Royce, you were like, the real deal right
there.
And
I'm going to take it a step further. Like, my dad was good with it because Clyde was legitimate. He wasn't selling dope.
Yeah.
He wasn't selling drugs.
He was
so
the real
it was
deal.
Somebody that the kids could be like, I want to be like him.
Right.
And he I want to dress like him and I want his shoes.
And everybody was like, Clyde was the guy.
So, growing up, me...
And we're from New York, so...
Of course.
You know, we were Knicks fans.
Yeah, but that was... You know, that was national, though. That was...
I know it went national, but, like, that's because Clyde... His name was Clyde. Like, his Walt Frazier was Clyde. Like, that's something else. Like, the name sounded cooler than everything. You know what I'm saying? So, it was all cool, and then he's the coolest. Mm. Like, at that time in basketball, no one was cooler than Clyde. So, it was the thing to be. You wanted to be like that guy.
And I say that because that seed obviously began to grow more with kids, basketball players, sneakers, being fresh.
Absolutely.
Being a baller. Like, that even that concept of being a baller was like, oh, you ain't got the big check. You're a baller now.
Right.
That was a basketball thing, right?
Yeah, without question. Pee-wee Kirkland.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that has been a part of our culture. And so now you take that to street culture where you have cats who are living that street life, but they want to be fly like the ballers.
Oh, yeah, for sure. For sure. You want to, like I said, when you're young in New York and your superheroes usually are basketball players, not even football players because you can't see their face. Basketball players, you can see their face. Baseball players, it was almost a white man's sport. So you really didn't go crazy for them unless you like sports. But the basketball player was a superhero. And the basketball in the hood was the easiest game for kids to play.
Well, it's free. All you need is a ball. Matter of fact, you don't even need a ball. You just show up to the court. Somebody got a ball.
Right. Yep. And you need the sneakers.
Yep.
So the bottom line was you need sneakers and you need a court to go to. That means it starts from the bottom up. Mm-hmm. So when you see guys being fresh and having money, it was the guys who started from the ground, from the feet up. And usually those guys played some kind of basketball. So you're 9 and there's a superhero on your block who's the toughest guy on the block. He's in a gang. Or he's the guy who takes care of everybody on the block. Or he might have some money because he hustles, but his sneakers are brand new. You want to be like that guy. And that's where Fresh started from. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Gotta be fresh out.
You
the
gotta
box.
Be fresh. And you, know,
I remember fighting with my, because in I grew up in Los Angeles, right? But I remember, I think that's why I had my love for Jordan ones. But you know, from coast to coast, it's different. We had, 100%. you know, we had.
You had Cortez.
Combos. We had Cortez. Couldn't even wear Cortez Nikes.
Dope man.
As much as I wanted them, I was like, my mom was like, nope. Because all of a sudden, man. We could get shot for wearing Cortez Nikes. But I just remember all the guys having Jordan ones.
Yo,
and my dad was like, that's not for you. But I remember them idolizing Michael Jordan and be like, I didn't care about basketball, but I cared about the sneakers.
Right.
I just remember begging and saving my money because I was like, yo, I'm going to get them. I'm going to save all my lunch money for these damn fucking sneakers. And I remember the sacrifice and learning. And my dad was like, really, you're going to spend all this money that you spent?
Were the Jordan 1s the first $100 sneaker?
Nah, I think they were like 85 when they first came out. First $100 sneaker.
Was it the Reebok Pump?
Fila's.
Fila's, really?
Yeah, I'm a sneaker junkie. So, right. Trust me.
Which ones?
Original Fila tennis made in Italy. I went to a store called Scandinavian to buy a jacket. Scandinavian's a ski shop. Mm. On the wall, they have sneakers. There was this sneaker. And they said it costs $110. And I was like, oh, I got to buy that just for stunt purposes.
Now, what year is this?
Oh, this is the 80s. I don't even remember what year.
And you was doing what for money?
Working.
Good for you. Hard working man. Working. Hard
but you have to understand, man. I've been DJ Clark Kent for a long time. Ebro.
I know.
You funny, boy. Well, we were working. But the thing is, I bought them, didn't know what
and
they
what
were.
And what neighborhood are you from for the people around?
I'm from
around
Crown Heights, Brooklyn.
You're from Brooklyn.
So I go back to my block, I put them on, and I wear them in front of the freshest dude on the block.
So this is 80, this call is 88?
Maybe. Nah, it's probably more like 80. Four, maybe. 84. It might be. I'm not remembering. But whenever it was, I went to the block and I wore them the same day. Just so the freshest dude on the block, who was super fresh, first dude I ever saw with Gucci sneakers, blew my mind. I put them on in front of him and he was like, oh, shit. And I was like, yes!
So that he, was he everything. Knew what time it was.
No, he didn't know what time it was. He was like, what the fuck? At all? And then it was like everything for me to go, these shit's $110. You don't want these.
Yo.
He was like, $110. Now, I'm young. He's like 25, but I'm super fresh to him right now. Funny. You don't understand. That moment, that probably might have fucked me up the most. Because I was already a sneaker junkie. Like, when I got on it, I was 9, and I was buying 2 pair of shoes every weekend. Like, 9, because we would work for whoever on the block would give us a job. I take the money and go buy a pair of sneakers and come back just because Rolando had brand new sneakers. Ishmael had new sneakers.
Ishmael.
I'm Panamanian. So, that's a good name in Panama.
I know
don't do that to me.
I know you're Panamanian.
I'm saying, she laughed at Rolando. If you were my real name, what would she say? Now, anyway.
So now, but now, in the story, you know, which is interesting for you because you have, I mean, and it's been for a while, but you are known as one of the tastemakers in sneaker culture, right? Like, that's a common, you're a familiar face. And anything that has to do with sneakers and collection and et cetera, et cetera. And have been for some time.
Yeah.
But you were also, obviously, in the early 90s and into the mid-90s after working as a young man, becoming a DJ.
Oh, no. I was a DJ since I was 9.
Yeah, I know. But,
I was playing clubs when I was, like, 16.
Right. But then started producing.
Yeah, for sure.
And I think that's for the people watching wherever you are, it's an interesting piece. Run through some of the records that you've produced.
Troop Spread My Wings. Jay-Z, Brooklyn's Finest, Cashmere Thoughts. What's the other song?
Players Anthem.
Players Anthem. Need You Tonight. Rick Ross, Stay High, Super High. Like, it's a lot of records. Like, to Mariah Carey, Lover Boy, I think. It's a lot of records, but it's
trying to be humble.
I'm watching him.
I don't remember when the checks come in every quarter. Today, I don't. Really,
no, it's not.
I don't
that.
Even look at the report of where the money's coming from.
I'm gonna tell you why it's like that. It's like that because I don't look at what I.
You don't look
I've
at the
done.
Past, right?
No, I look for the future. Yeah, so what I do coming up to me means more than what I did before. Otherwise, I wouldn't still be so on. All the time.
Keeps you sharp.
Yeah, 100%.
You are, did I read it right or do I understand it right? You heavily responsible for connecting, getting the relationship with Hov and B.I.G. Was that, you were in that?
I introduced him in a session.
It was just a session with Big or session for
Session
Hov?
With Jay. but it was sparked on a session with B.I.G.
I was gonna
I did a beat for Jay for Brook with what became Brooklyn's Finest. It was gonna be called No More Mr. Nice Guy. That was one name, and the other name was Once We Get Started. But it was leaning more to No More Mr. Nice Guy. He said it on the record. Mm-hmm. And I was in a session with B.I.G. and he heard the beat by accident. It was purely accident. I didn't want him to hear it because I figured he would like it. And he did, and he wanted it. And he was like, let me get that. And I was like, no. And he says, why? And I'm like, I'm giving it to my man Jay. And he's like, you get that nigga everything. I'm like, well, he's my artist, so I should give him everything, right? And then he was like, nah, man, fuck that. I need to be on that record. I still don't know what made me say, all right, just come to the studio.
And it was wait. B.I.G.
No,
it was B.I.G.
And wait in the car. Who says that part? If I wasn't his B.I.G. homie, would he have waited in the car?
Nah. Right? Well, I think you wanted to make sure Jay was cool, right?
Nah, I wanted to make sure that Jay would say yes. And I just couldn't walk in and go, yo, B.I.G. want to get on the song. So it has to massage. So I get in the studio, I lay the beat, Jay goes in, he does the whole song. And then I'm like, yo, you should let B.I.G. on the song. Now, in nowadays times, you damn near have contracts written up before going, y'all are going to do this song together and this is what the splits are going to be, like before the beat is made. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Somebody's already politicking that. Jay finished the song. And I was like, yo, you should let B.I.G. on it. Kind of wrong for that. Yeah. But it had the massage. I was just like, oh, shit, dope.
Had to finesse
we should put B.I.G. on it. And everybody's like, niggas, you crazy. And Dame was like, nah, and fuck that, because we ain't giving Puff no money. Like dead seriously, that's how it went down. And then Jay was like, well, we don't know him. And I was like, well, you know I know him. He's like, well, if he want to get on it and you can make it happen, cool. But Dame again says, but we ain't paying Puff no money. And I was like, that might be the tough part, but I don't care. So I act like I'm going to the bathroom, go downstairs, bring him up. The whole room goes, you a funny nigga. And they met each other. And there might have been 2 seconds of conversation. And then it was laughter. And then Jay stood there for 20 to 25 minutes listening to the beat. And then goes in the booth and does what you hear. Mm. And comes back out and goes, are you ready? And B.I.G.'s like, what the fuck are you talking about? And then he looks at me and goes, what the fuck did he just do? I was like, well, I told you he doesn't write rhymes. Like, he thinks them and he goes in and he does it. And he was just like, Clark, that shit was crazy. I was like, I told you my man's ill. And then he was like, no, I'm not ready. I'll come back for this. 2 months later, he came back. And you have arguably the best collabo record ever. Yeah. Collabo rap record ever.
It's up there.
I'm like, show
and
me.
And the reason it's up there is because when you listen to it, you hear both artists recognizing each other's skill set and wanting the record to be great,
right?
Not just their verse.
But then it's called Brooklyn's Finest. Mm-hmm. Like, Brooklyn's best MC, Brooklyn's best rapper, Brooklyn's best DJ. We could have made an album called Brooklyn's Finest. Mm-hmm. And it would have been, nobody could have argued the point. Nobody could have said, nah, he should be on it, or this person should. Like, at that precise moment in Brooklyn, who was where I was at as a DJ? Nobody. So where's the argument here?
Do you, when you look back on your relationship with Jay, other than his skill set and his ability to rap, right? And him being a fly guy, already having money, being you guys just knowing each other from just being out and about.
Right.
Was that what sold you on, yo, I need to do an album with them and create?
No. What sold me was when Jazz introduced me, Brooklyn believed Jazz was the best thing in the world. And then he introduced me, and this guy is as good as Jazz, but he has something else. So at that point, like 15, 16, I'm just like, no, he's special. But then things happened. He went the way that he went. I was the way that I went. But when I got the ability to work with artists, he was the first on the list.
And what was the time? How much time passed between Jazzo introduced him to you? And
maybe 8, 10 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, like he was fine. He didn't he trust me, when I tell you, it was a struggle to get him to rap. He was just like, fuck this shit. 100%
like, I don't understand where the money's at here. Like, I'm getting money and why would I do that?
It was that one, and it was also the way that we kind of looked at rappers. It was like, y'all want to be like us. Mm-hmm. So why do we do what you do when y'all want to be like us?
Y'all tell our stories. I'm really living this life.
Like, no, we're really like that. You're not. So yeah. Why should I do what you're doing so that I could become you when I'm already the guy that you want to be?
Hmm. And B.I.G., when you saw his
talent,
career path and trajectory,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I knew.
Right off.
Right out the gate. But I knew when Un told me about him. I knew when 50 and C was talking about him. I knew before he was in the Source magazine, I was like, he's special. So,
and what did you hear?
Yeah, when did you first meet him too?
And you'll see where I'm taking you.
Okay, I heard.
What did you hear?
I heard his flow and his voice. His voice is stupid.
When you say voice, what are you saying?
Like, his voice, his actual, speaking, when he rhymes,
right.
What you heard. Mm-hmm. Like
the sound, the tonnage,
the tonnage and sound of his voice on a beat was like, move everybody out of the room. I'm about to rap now and it's going to hit you.
I'm present.
Yeah, like, no, his, all he had to do was go, and you was like, yes. You know what I'm saying? And like, you just knew it was coming. So like, and when you look at Jay, like, you didn't know it until some years went by and then the cha-cha-cha became something to you. You know what I'm saying? Or you was like, oh shit, it's gonna happen. But when Big, right out the gate, when he hit the you were like, fuck, it's gonna be crazy. And then it was crazy.
The reason I walked you down that path of hearing something in someone's voice, mm-hmm. and the energy and their presence on a recorded element, and you being a producer that's worked with singers and rappers,
mm-hmm.
In today, in the creation of music, specifically hip hop, is that, do you feel like that knowledge is being shared as of presence and being on recorded material the same way you would be present on stage, et cetera, et cetera?
No, it's not.
And just because
you just asked the question, yeah, I just answered it.
It's just not.
Yeah, you know, like when you know how when you go to court and they say answer the question and it's a yes or no question and you give them the yes or no, but they're really waiting for you to say something else. Ebro, you are. What are you doing here? Okay, what do you want to ask me? Ask the
no,
real
no,
question.
No, because it's a learning experience for right. everyone. Listening and watching is because I feel like that piece for several reasons.
No, it's definitely missing.
For several reasons, though,
yeah,
right?
For
like
sure.
The barriers to entry are less. Like, I could just make a song on my phone, put it on SoundCloud, and people will proclaim that I'm a legend and I'm a goat and I'm iconic. Like, these words get thrown around off of a demo version of a song on whatever. And there are instances where there are individuals that literally the moment you hear them, it's like,
yeah, you
but
get
then
it.
There's so many others mm-hmm. that aren't that. Right.
I believe that. Before you believe that you're making records, you should record yourself and hear yourself. And the thing is, if you can't understand everything that you're saying, maybe you should wait until you can understand everything that you're saying.
But now it's cool to not understand.
No, it's not cool. It's stupid. Is it cool or is it stupid? Be honest. Well, I'm asking you. I'm not asking
now,
the world.
No. For me, my interpretation of it, for me, I don't like it.
Okay, that's what I'm asking you. I'm not asking you anything more than that. Don't go any further.
No, but it's a point for the audience is to understand that sometimes people find it's fun to be stupid and it's cool to be stupid.
No, that's absolutely never going to be true. How can it be okay to be stupid realistically? So no matter how we try to box it and package it and make it sound different, I'm sorry, ignorance is not bliss. Ignorance is ignorant. So stupid is stupid. That's that. I'd rather do some smart shit all the time than to do some stupid shit some of the time. Maybe it'll be taken as smart because I'm smart. Mm-hmm. Nah, don't be stupid on purpose. So you know who's gonna last when you hear it. When you heard Big's voice, the first time you heard him on a record, as soon as he was on that Mary J. Blige record, as soon as he was on Party and Bullshit, you were like, yeah, he's going to be around for a good long time.
So for the audience listening, it's like, oh, we just some old people sitting around reminiscing about the past. Who today does Clark Kent feel that way about?
Drake, Kanye, Kendrick, Pusha, Fab for as long as he's been around. Like, Fab is fucking amazing. You know what I'm saying? But you have to understand, the reason why I listen to rap the way I listen to rap is because I heard the first best MC all the time. The first best MC was Grandmaster Caz, and he was amazing. And then you got Melly Mel, who's amazing, and Shaheem from the Infinity Crew, who's amazing, and Ruby D, and Tito, and Mike C, and Peso, and DLB, and these guys who... Kumo D, like, I was in the club watching Kumo D. Like, how can I not hear rap a certain way? So when I hear rap a certain way, it should say really good things. So when I'm listening now, I want to hear guys say really good things and hear you hear it well.
And when you say hear it well, you're not just talking about what the words they're using. What else are you saying?
I want to hear you enunciate it properly. I want to hear you sound right on music.
And you're talking about the tone of your voice matching with the melodies, et cetera,
yeah,
et cetera.
Yeah, like, and if it cuts so that you can enjoy the music and then still pay great attention to what the person is saying, you should be okay.
Do you, and through Go ahead.
Whenever you heard Big Rhyme, didn't it sound like it was inside of the music? Mm-hmm. It didn't sound like it was laying on top of it? That's why it was amazing. Amazing, because it sounded like he was a part of.
And what I'm hearing you saying is the voice is a part of the music, 100%. Not separate.
No way.
And so if you have great bars, like you rap great, that doesn't mean you're going to make great music.
Oh, hell no. Hell no. I just wish it was, because I'd rather hear guys that say really good rhymes than to hear guys that don't say as good rhymes making great records. But the one thing I do know, and it's probably the conflict within me, is that the music business does not care about the bars. It cares about the song. So if you know that the song is what sells, not the bars, and I'm a guy who wants to hear bars, it's a conflict sometimes. So when I do decide...
But you've been able to... You and your path have been able to accomplish both.
Oh, yeah, because... Here's why. Because I'm a DJ first. So producing records is really secondary to me. And even though it makes you good money, and even though it does something good for your career, producing records will always be secondary to me, because I am really picky about who I'm gonna create a soundtrack for. And when I create soundtracks for somebody, I'm creating the record. I'm not creating a beat for you to run to. So I'm already picturing what you should be doing or how it should come across. So, like, I'm trying to sonically be right because I'm a DJ, but I'm a DJ first. So I don't really, particularly, I'm not out there chasing to go produce somebody. So I'm looking at a lot of rappers like, I'm not wasting that drum machine time.
Can you think of a time previous to now? I'm sure there's several, where there was something that was very popular and trendy. Mm-hmm. And either you didn't like it or you knew it wasn't going to last or somewhere in there. Like, because I've obviously seen it several times, right? Where it's like, oh, this is a passing phase. This isn't the type of music that stands the test of time. Do you remember any of those times?
I think it's been going on for a long time.
No, it has, of
like,
course.
Artists getting record deals because you cool with the guy who really deserves a record deal, that is the most fucked up shit in the game. And that's...
Say that again.
Guys who get record deals because you're cool with the guy who's supposed to have the record deal is the most fucked up shit in the world. So, like, you're an artist and you're a dope and you get a label deal and then you sign somebody and he's really not that dope. Like, what were you doing? That guy doesn't deserve his space on that record label. Why'd you give him a budget? You could do something else with that.
But and, it's my man. It's my
yeah,
boy.
That's my
it's
man.
My cousin.
And I'm hooking him up.
Baby mama's brother.
Yeah, you're wrong. You're wrong. Like, that's a waste of budget right there. Mm-hmm. Don't do that. And it's been going on for a long time.
And you're not, it doesn't sound like you're from the school of, and your respect for music, doesn't sound like you're from the school of...
We Could Fix It?
No.
Oh.
well, no, not that school. But the school of, like, taking it lightly, taking this music and this hip-hop thing lightly.
Nah, I saw...
Because people take it light.
I saw hip-hop begin. And because I saw hip-hop begin, I saw the first rappers. And because I saw what it took to be a great rapper, I care more about the music that lives inside of our culture than the person who lives outside who just cares about the music. Because that music is a direct representation of this thing that we created. So if you're making bad representations of our thing, of this culture, and just saying, oh, it's rap. Yeah, it's rap for you, but rap is the music that represents this thing that I come from. This
which
thing
is,
that I,
which
I,
is the sneakers, all of the fashion,
like,
the,
I come from
the music, the clubs, the
all of that, the whole picture,
the whole thing.
Hip hop is
the
whole
art
picture.
That Laura's into, the street art that now you got artists that used to sneak out their mama's bedroom and
now you're
damn get killed on trains and make $500,000. That's hip hop. Like,
yeah,
we did that.
That's this thing that we built.
Yeah.
So I feel like, yo, what you're doing, if it doesn't resonate properly, maybe you should call it something else. Mm. Don't call it rap if it's supposed... See, a lot of people get confused with the music and say it's hip-hop music. It's not hip-hop music. It's rap music. It's rap music that lives within the culture of hip-hop. Hip-hop music... Mary J. Blige made hip-hop music. Are you going to say she's a rapper? No. It's the music that lives within the culture. She's the queen of hip-hop soul. Why? Because her music felt like hip-hop. And it was soulful. So when I look at this thing called rap, I'm like, please let it get better because it represents this thing that people have been...
You feel like it's in a bad place?
Here's the thing. I don't feel like it's in a bad place because there was always bad rap. It's just that you didn't hear it.
Right.
But because the world is so big and so small at the same time, you can hear some bullshit now. And what's bad is... It's almost like there's a fan base of people who are accepting bad rap because they can't rap. Also, they can't sing along with a record. So they're already looking at a bad rapper going, he's my hero.
Because I see myself
right. being able to do that.
And that's happened with all types of music for a long time.
And it's really fucked up.
Yeah.
But it's not that many people who are going to speak from the place that I speak because I can make a record and I play clubs and I saw Grandmaster Caz. You know what I'm saying? If there's people who will never ever hear what he sounded like and won't be able to grasp the rappers around at that time and go, oh shit, I get it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? The shit he was saying was sick and he said it so well. He was dope. He was Grandmaster Caz.
Facts.
He could DJ his ass off too.
When I was just about to go there, for my own learning,
mm-hmm.
because obviously the rapper, the MC, if you will, is seen as the biggest thing in hip hop. It's the face.
Right.
But there was a time when I was the DJ.
Yeah, for sure.
To what degree in your experience did cracking this microphone and rocking that party, finding the break and all that, I'm kind of leading you down the path, so it's a horrible question in some ways. Open the door for the MC. Because you had people like Hollywood that were as big in this town as when fucking Parliament came, as when Prince came through.
Absolutely.
There were real artists with hit songs that did not want to perform.
Not when Hollywood
was running.
Nope. Okay.
And can you articulate what that DJ on the microphone...
Okay, if a DJ could use the mic properly, i.e. Kid Capri, i.e. Hollywood, i.e. Star Child, i.e. Brucey B, if you could use the mic as well as you could use turntables, you didn't need anybody. So you were a superstar.
You could rock the party
with your hands and then open the mic and take the party up another level. That left you being a superstar. Now, if you're the guy like me who won't talk on a mic, who has to use these, it made you master the craft. But this, if you got a guy who can select good records mentally, play them on time, and then crack that mic, he's definitely your illest threat. So when you had that guy, yeah, of course I can imagine a parliament going, nah, do not put him in that building when I'm around.
Because he's playing all the hit songs. Yeah, he's got everybody.
Right. He's already musically killing you. And then.
Then, bah, da, da, bah, da, bang.
Yeah, when he opens that mic, it's going to hurt.
Yeah.
Yeah. When he hits that study of lessons, you're going to be like, oh, shit, did he say that? When he hits you with the Wu-Tang, you're like, oh, fuck, what just happened? You know what I'm saying? And he was rapping and singing and everything. Like, it was all happening. Hollywood was amazing. Amazing. And I used to see it firsthand all the time.
His name is DJ Clark Kent. He wears T-shirts that say, God's favorite DJ.
Who but made it's the truth.
Who made... Where'd you get that shirt?
It was crafted.
You made it?
Nope. I don't make shirts.
Somebody gave it to him.
Yo, you funny, man.
Who gave you that nickname, though?
God.
What? He speaks to him every day.
Without a question. If you take your time and say your prayers, if you're one who really believes, he'll tell you, Clark, it's my favorite.
You see how you went into DJ mode right away? Flex has that little switch, too, where they'd be mad, humble, and chill. And you say something about DJing, and they'd be like, because that's what I mean.
Okay.
Rappers have it, too. Rappers have it, too. I do it, too, sometimes. You start playing with me, I'll switch on you. But Hov does it. You'll be talking to a guy named Sean Carter, who's the nice, most humble, nicest guy ever.
Yeah, but he's also the nicest guy on the mic, so you can switch that switch real quick.
But when he switches, you'll be like, oh, I'm talking to a rapper now.
But on that set, though, yeah. But the only reason why I'm like that is because, again, I come from the beginning of hip-hop, and hip-hop was a contact sport.
Fact.
You didn't get famous unless you were that shit.
Well, and also, you was getting snatched off the set if you was trash.
Yeah.
You was getting booed if you was trash. Yeah. You was not getting booked if you was trash.
Yeah.
Don't try to be an MC and somebody, like, give you their stage time, throw on a break, and you doo-doo?
Right.
Or nowadays, you rappers who get up here and complain about the beat we throw on.
If a rapper comes up here and he complains about a beat that you throw on, honestly, you should ask them to leave.
Facts. You're right.
And I understand I understand that y'all are doing a service, but that artist is doing a disservice to the craft that you care about. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? If you didn't care about him being a rapper or MC, you wouldn't say, spit.
You know what it is? We have gotten to a point as elder statesmen, or at least I have, where while I'm going to give a rapper a hard time, I'm going to give a producer a hard time, I'm going to give a DJ a hard time, I'm going to give a radio host a hard time, I'm going to give a radio program a hard time. I've been in it long enough I can do that. When young people are coming up, I don't want to crush them completely. I think that's kind of the parent in me, where it's like I don't...
So you're saying if you didn't have Izzy, you'd crush artists?
I was worse.
I was worse.
You know what? I applaud you for...
I was worse.
For being nicer.
And I still, the audience still gives me, they think I'm horrible. They don't even know what I used to be.
If an audience is giving you hell, the audience has only been paying attention since you were giving them a video platform.
Right.
That means they never paid attention properly. Because as long as I know, you've been going, yo, spit some. But the reason why you say spit some is because you believe you should be good. So you're giving them the chance. So like if you're going, you know what, you're trash on your records, but I'm going to give you a chance to fix yourself.
Because you say you rap.
Right.
You say this is hip-hop.
So rap, B. Rap. Because you know what? I have to look at you guys and applaud y'all because I'd be like, get the fuck out of here. And I wouldn't be diplomatic. I'd be like, oh, you're not going to rap, but you call yourself a rapper? Get the fuck out of here. And they would hate me. You know what I'm saying? And I'd be cool with them hating me because I'd be protecting this thing. You know what I'm saying? Like I'm older than a lot of us, you know what I'm saying? So, like, I really care. You know what I'm saying? Like I said,
You walk a fine line because, you know, the audience, like we spoke about, they just want to be entertained, right? That's how we all stay employed, by entertaining the masses. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that's what I signed up for.
I bet it would
get
real entertaining if you started telling motherfuckers to get the fuck out of here. Yeah. If you ain't going to rap, get the fuck out of here. Well, you know why?
He has sometimes.
Here's the deal.
I don't put those interviews out. Stop.
But here's the deal. It will probably make the people who are paying attention to what you're doing here go, why did he do that?
Scotty's mad because I don't put out the interviews where I kick people out of the studio.
Oh, you definitely should. You know why? Because it would make the buying public or the people who are supporting these artists go, why did he do that? And then, I swear to God, like, I'm going to say this, and I never thought I would say this, but Google really is everyone's friend, because then they'll go, well, let me see why. And they'll look, and they'll go, why did he say he was trash? And they'll look, and they'll go, oh, I get it. He's trash. So maybe he should have kicked them out. Yes, he kicked them out. Yes, Ebro, they might not get it when you're doing it, but they're going to get it somewhere down the line. Because you're protecting the craft.
I'm too nice, guys. I'm old and nice.
Well, how do you deal with that? Because you DJ all over the world and you DJ all kind of events. What about when you have your opening DJ, right? That is maybe DJing with, you know, maybe not mixing or not scratching at all. Just kind of slapping records on.
The
pre-mix.
Ooh, the pre-mix.
A pre-mix.
The mix is already done. They just up there waving their hands.
What do you say?
Because
they look at you like, oh my God, Clark Kent, the legend. What do you say when you're watching them do this?
I don't say anything.
Nothing.
Nah, you understand me. Again, I come from the contact sport era of DJing. So I'm like, you're going to do what you choose. Either you're going to choose to go all out because I'm coming on, or you're just going to keep being garbage because you're garbage. I would rather you do your best shit, because that only turns my volume up. You good, I'm going to be better. It doesn't matter who's on. If you're good, I'm going to be better. I'm programmed that way. If you're trash, I'm still going to kill you. But it's just going to be worse because you didn't get your shit off.
You're not going to hit him off, my man. You should really learn how to mix.
Here's the reason why I won't, is because they believe they can. Like, anybody put DJ in front of their name, they actually believe they can. I'm not going to take that away from you. But you're going to learn. Nah, what you were doing wasn't actually what this is.
I don't know. I don't know if they're going to learn, though.
Trust me. They learn.
Because they're getting away with it. We've been to some situations where I'm like, I don't even understand how this person made it this far. And it's continuing.
You know why? Because they got the lowest price.
Not only that, but who are they on the bill with? And what is that person doing to them after they get off? A conversation isn't needed if you're going to put the work to them. You know what I'm saying? I've been involved in situations where people felt they were absolutely amazing until I was done. Do what you're going to do, B. Like, have the time of your life. Play the 10 best records out. I'm going to take the same 10 records, and I'm going to play them the way they were supposed to be played. You're going to learn today. I promise you. Flex does not walk into a situation with a dude who's DJing in front of him worried. Kid Capri does not walk into a situation with a dude that's playing before him worried. Jeff. Scratch, any DJ with chops does not walk into a situation worried about what the DJ playing before him is playing. He's probably just wondering, how much is it going to hurt? Me, I don't even give a fuck. Like, I don't care what you did. I came to do my job. Be great.
What's that, Scott?
I love that.
I'm just saying, in order to protect the culture, right, I would think that you would say something to these DJs.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, that would help them because you want to see them grow. You want to see them do well.
Okay, cool. If I assault each DJ, they're going to get their feelings hurt.
It's not assaulting, though.
No, listen.
So is Ebro kicking somebody out of the room.
Yeah, but that's realer because they're making records.
It's different because you're already at the platform.
You're at the platform when you're making records. When you're in a club, the DJ who's coming on is going to crush you. And that should learn. You should learn something from that. But even though I don't say maybe you should work on that, I get on Twitter from ever so often and I explain how to be better because I give a fuck. Like, honestly, I could not care, keep collecting my paper and be good. But no, I give a fuck. I don't want you to be whack. DJ, I'm a DJ, so I got to protect you. Mm-hmm. So what do I do? I explain. Yo, that sync button, never touch it. Yeah, this is a mixer. Learn how to use it. Oh, by the way, beat matching, that doesn't happen in the computer. You shouldn't use the computer. Actually put some vinyl on and learn. Oh, you use a controller? That's controlling you. The fuck are you doing on that? It's DJing for you. Use turntables, DJ.
I don't even know how to use a controller. You just hit a button?
It just looks nuts.
No, what's crazy?
Or an iPod or something, I don't know.
Understand me. I got hired one time.
Is it like a sync button on the...
I have no fucking idea what it does. Honestly, I walked into an event where They hired me. I gave them a rider, two 1200s, and a mixer. I walk in, there's a controller. I had my first half, and I get paid before I start. So I got paid and walked out. Where are you going? Where are you going? You don't have the shit that I asked you for. You don't have the rider that I gave you. Like, I'm a professional. If I show up and my shit ain't the way I said it should be, because you gave me the ability to tell you what I want, like, if you don't give me the ability and I walk in, it's different. But I'm smart enough to say, here's a rider. This is how I DJ. You hired me because of what I do, so.
That's how the greats do it, man. So, y'all think I'm bad.
This isn't bad.
I'm the nice guy.
This isn't bad. Go ask a rapper.
Clark, would you tell him in my world, I'm considered the nice guy?
You are a nice guy.
No, you're not.
With the OGs, with them.
You have to understand, like, what somebody should be able to.
They be talking to me like, yo, Ebro, what the fuck is wrong with you, man? I'd be like, yo, I'm trying to get these young kids a shot. You know, I beat them up a little bit.
See, to me, I look at you in the position that you all are in, and you actually have the key to the door. So with that key, you should be very careful with it. So when somebody's in the door, you should be able to go, should I lock you out because you are fucking up my shit? Or should I just keep rocking because there's a bunch of whack people that think you're dope for a second and let it ride out? And then when you die off, I'm cool.
Here's the part where when it dies off or when they don't really get to the level they expect it to be at. Because it's happened, and specifically in this latest iteration of hip hop over the last 3 years, right? It's a lot of noise. A lot of people could sell some concert tickets and get a lot of likes and things like that and streams, maybe sell some records, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then what? Because the and then what is where DJs, radio, and cats had been in it for a while ago, well, you thought you was hot. What you about to do now? Because your records was trending. What does that mean, right? And so I find joy in that piece, right? Because that, I believe, is the learning part. Where last year you was on all the festivals. This year you're coming to me trying to figure out what exactly I should do to stay hot, right? And so I think that's the learning. And maybe I should be doing a better job of documenting where artists get cold, because I don't think we're maybe doing that part in this latest iteration of hip hop, where 18 months ago we was talking about so-and-so. The XXL Freshman 10 is a great start to that, because you can go to each cover and see who made it and who didn't, right? And then you can start to, they're about 45 to 50% ratio too. We had a combo here on the show, right, where we went through each cover.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can start to maybe learn why this one didn't survive and this one did, what they did, how they changed their brand, how their brand evolved, what type of music they were making. Were they making real music or just computer-generated cool shit?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because that's a very different thing, too. Are you using a bunch of computer tools or are you using real vocals, instruments?
Are you making great music? Are you making great songs?
So it is a great con, even with the DJs, right?
Yeah.
DJs that are just doing the cool little hipster little parties, and you're trendy and you're doing whatever the cool party is of the day.
You can do any kind of party, though, as long as you can play. You can hear it.
But then there's DJs that are able to sustain and really make a living doing it, and then there's people who do it just... Sorry. Because I ain't got nothing else better to do.
Well, there you have it. No, I'm saying one of those guys who's sustaining. I'm sustainable.
You're God's favorite DJ. That's what the shirt is. Absolutely. That's what the shirt is.
No, that's what everybody understands. they understand
the
it,
The Ultimate
baby.
Sneaker Expo is going down where?
At the Sports Arena in Smithtown, New York.
Yeah, now let's get back to the sneakers. See, he gets all humble and bashful with the sneakers.
Our very own Camilo's joining him, too.
Yes, the heavy, heavy hitter. Roc Nation's own DJ Camilo.
Is Cass 1 on the party?
No.
Not this one.
But he's done it before.
Sherrod.
Cass has done a bunch of them.
He's a big sneakerhead.
I think he did a Westchester one and the one before.
Yeah, yeah.
Clark, between me and you, there's a thing between Juanito and Cass.
What's the thing?
Well, that's why he didn't bring up, like, if he's on it, you would think he would bring his compadre, his co-worker, his guy in the sneaker.
No, don't, he's just trying to start shit. Don't listen to him, man. No,
he didn't bring it up to you, he never even brought it up till right now, did he?
I love Cass.
Honestly, you didn't even tell me you was doing this, Juanito. Same.
You're not giving it funky with your people.
I didn't put it together. I'm just part of the team.
Oh, you don't put it together now.
Well, he didn't put it together.
Yeah.
This one right here, well, let me say this. Him, He's the guy.
Shout him out because they
can't.
DJ Sherrod is the reason I'm actually doing sneaker shows, is because I sat down with him and my boy Mike Siegel, and they convinced me.
Hi, Mike.
And because of their energy, I was like, okay, bet. And then we got Erica, give me two pairs to get down with us, and she's like the glue that makes everything come together so that we roll along properly. So this small team that I have here, also Manu is dope too, but this small team is the reason why this can actually happen. So
Ultimate Sneaker Expo, the Holla, date once again.
September 17th.
Yo, give it up for DJ Clark Kent. Yay! Ebro in the morning. Great talk, sir. Great talk.
When we gonna come here and sit down and talk how DJs are trash too?
Oh my God.